Thank you for joining me today for the product and technology presentation. My name is Andrew Goldschmidt. I'm the air quality product manager with Dwyer Instruments. And today I'm going to talk to you about the characteristics of thermal anemometers and why they're well suited for low flow applications. So today, for those of you who don't know much about Dwyer Instruments, I'll tell you a little bit about the company that I work for. I'll go through and I'll talk about what exactly is air velocity or airflow, and I'll talk about how you can go through and actually measure your air velocity or airflow, primarily with two different types of technology, either pressure or temperature-based instrumentation. From there, we'll talk about some of the limitations to each of these technologies, and I'll go through some of the common applications and questions that we see come up about how to monitor air velocity in HVAC equipment. And then from there, just kind of close on what we covered during today's presentation. So for those of you who aren't familiar with Dwyer Instruments and haven't worked with Dwyer before, we've been manufacturing instrumentation for the HVAC market since 1931. Most people know Dwyer Instruments for our air differential pressure gauge, our MagnaHelic, which we started manufacturing in 1953. And as you can see here, things have drastically changed from 1953 to today. We had more manual processes when manufacturing these gauges, and now we're using things like collaborative robots that allow us to improve our efficiency and the quality of the products that we manufacture. Dwyer is a U.S. manufacturer. We employ over 650 people, primarily in the Midwest. So we have manufacturing facilities in Indiana, Missouri, and Minnesota. Now, while our technologies may have changed, our key core values that we instill in our customers and our employees haven't changed. And those core values include the spirit of winning, innovation, and people excellence. So now that you know a little bit more about Dwyer and kind of how we're qualified for talking about air velocity, I'll give you some information on exactly what is air velocity. So air velocity is defined as the area of air movement measured in distance traveled relative to time elapsed, and it's commonly measured in units of meters per second or feet per minute. Now there's really three different types of flow or three different flow profiles that you'll see when monitoring air velocity. And those three profiles are laminar flow, transitional flow, and turbulent flow. And the way that you're going to move from a laminar flow through a transitional flow to a turbulent flow is commonly done by turning the air. And the most common way to do this is by introducing something such as an elbow in the ductwork. Today's discussion is really going to be focused more on the laminar flow profile. So how do you actually go through and measure air velocity? The most common way for monitoring air velocity is with pressure-based instrumentation. And pressure-based airflow measurements are derived from the Bernoulli equation, which is accounting for air density, static pressure, and total pressure. So to go through and monitor your static pressure and total pressure, you need some form of instrument there to measure this. And there's really two different ways of doing this. You can do this with using two separate sensors, so one for monitoring your static pressure, which is ultimately the pressure that's pushing against the inner walls of the ductwork itself, and your total pressure, which is then going to be the pressure that's induced from the flow moving through the ductwork itself. So two sensors takes a little bit more time to install, so there's a secondary device that's used for monitoring air velocity. And anybody that traveled to this show that took an airplane, for example, would have seen one of these devices on that airplane. And that device is a pitot tube. And essentially what a pitot tube is it's a tube inside of a tube for monitoring your velocity pressure. So you have an inner tube that's monitoring this static pressure and an outer tube that then has smaller holes drilled into it for monitoring what your static pressure is. So now this one device, the difference between your total and static pressure, then gives you what your velocity pressure is. And that's what we're using then for calculating our airflow. So Bernoulli developed this equation that accounts for how you can calculate your air velocity in usable units of either feet per minute or meters per second. And there's a number of different tools that are available in the market for kind of simplifying this process. So if any of you have ever used any test equipment, a lot of them are doing built-in calculators in this test equipment that converts your velocity pressure into feet per minute. And this is based off of this Bernoulli equation. Dwyer manufactures and produces catalogs that list all of this information, and this is just a snip of that equation and it being simplified. So the most common one that most HVAC technicians would use and know is this 4,004.4 times the square root of your velocity pressure. And what that's doing is it's converting your velocity pressure in inches of water column to a usable flow in feet per minute at standard conditions. The other way that you can go through and monitor your air velocity is by using temperature-based instrumentation or anemometers. And temperature-based airflow measurements are derived from King's Law, which is mathematically describing heat transfer in air flows using a heated wire. So what's happening here is air is moving over the wire, which causes a loss of temperature in the wire, and then removes some of that wire's heat energy. So this change is calculated typically using a Wheatstone bridge to determine the resistance change that is then correlated to the speed of the air moving across the sensor. So essentially what you have in an anemometer are two temperature sensors. One is your reference and your second that's monitoring the air that's moving across that sensor. And what happens is, as your air velocity speeds up, you're pulling more energy off of that temperature sensor. And from there, we can correlate that loss in energy to an air velocity. So now that we know how you can monitor air velocity, you might be saying, well, what's the advantage to using pressure, or what's the advantage to using temperature? And this is where we did more of the engineering behind how you go through and monitor air velocity. So here we did CFD modeling of both pitot tubes and thermal anemometers as well for monitoring airflow. And what we're seeing here is really what the Bernoulli equation is not accounting for, which is going to be changes in viscosity of the air itself. So the Bernoulli equation is setting your viscosity to a constant value. But as we know, viscosity is constantly changing dependent upon the temperature in the airflow. So when we start looking at this at a finite level, we start to see what happens as you speed up and slow down the air velocity. The other kind of unique phenomena that we saw when slowing down our air velocity was that these little holes for these static pressure pickups actually change the flow profile right around the pitot tube. So you're transitioning from this laminar to more of a turbulent flow when you slow down your air velocity. So this is a little bit of the math of what we're starting to see with the pitot tube itself. And as you can see, the pitot tube is very accurate itself at higher air velocities. But once we start to reduce our air velocity below, say, 400 feet per minute, we start to see that error increase. And really what we're accounting for here is just the accuracy itself of the pitot tube. The other thing that we need to be looking at and considering is most building management systems, most PLCs, they're not taking a pneumatic input. They want a linear input, typically analog, for what that pressure is. So now you're going through and you're converting this very low velocity pressure, and when we back into it using our Bernoulli equation, we see at 200 feet per minute, you're yielding an air velocity of 0.002 inches of water column. Now there are some specialized differential pressure sensors in the market that can monitor these air velocities, but they're typically very expensive for monitoring these very low velocities and very low velocity pressures. And that's really where you might start to look at other technologies for those flows. So we did the same type of modeling as well for our temperature-based thermoanemometers. And we saw some similar characteristics. We saw that the size of the RTD and the thermistors used for monitoring the flow slightly affect the velocity there. But the one major advantage that we have when using temperature-based instrumentation is that we can go through and use a process called sensor characterization to account for some of these changes in temperature, humidity, and pressure. So what sensor characterization is it's defined as the process of taking measurements from a sensor under controlled conditions. And ultimately, sensor characterization ensures that a guaranteed level of readout accuracy over various operating conditions, such as temperature, humidity, or atmospheric pressure. So at Dwyer Instruments, we use calibrated references to repeat our processes to allow us to characterize our air velocity sensors for both temperature and humidity changes in the process or that air moving through your ductwork. So this characterization of the sensors yields a uniform sensor accuracy across a specific range. So ultimately what we're doing is we're varying the temperature, the velocity, and we're taking what we're seeing there and programming that into our sensor to allow it to have a uniform accuracy across the full range that the product is being used for. So now that we know a little bit more about how these sensors work themselves, you might be wondering what applications you would be using these sensors in. So one of the more common ones that we've been seeing more and more questions come up on is how you can go through and monitor air velocity and specifically air changes per hour in critical environments. So we know from the ANSI and the ASHRAE standard that there are minimum requirements necessary for how many air changes are occurring per hour. And this equates to both fresh air that's coming into the area as well as just the total number of air changes per hour. And when we go through and we look at these critical environments, such as operating rooms, we know that we want to be changing the air over frequently, but we know that the faster we move the air, the more likely we're going to move contaminants, dirt, particulate. So we want to be moving that air, but we want to move it at a very low air velocity so that we're not going to contaminate that area. And what we can see is that most of these operating rooms are typically running anywhere between 37 to 55 feet per minute, so very low air velocities. And if we're to go through and monitor how many air changes are occurring per hour, the easiest way to do that is to monitor the air going into the room and the air going out of the room. And by monitoring these very low air flows, we can make sure that we're conforming to these ANSI and ASHRAE standards that specify how many air changes are occurring per hour. And with the flows being so low, for these types of applications, we recommend using temperature-based instrumentation. Now on the other side, really what a lot of us are seeing here and this week during the AHR show is more commercial HVAC systems. So here you're going through and you're monitoring your air velocity rates in places such as hotels, schools, stores, offices. And from there, we can see that your typical velocity ranges are going to be really anywhere from 1 to 3,000 feet per minute for your main supply ducts and 500 to 1,500 feet per minute for branch supply ducts. So again, we can use our Bernoulli equation, account for standard conditions, and see that our velocity pressure is really ranging anywhere from 0.016 to 0.561 inches of water column. So from there we know that we can use things such as pressure-based instrumentation for monitoring these air velocities, or we could use temperature-based instrumentation. Now one of the things that we need to consider when we're using pressure-based devices is these devices are giving you a reading in inches of water column. Now there are some devices in the market that are doing that square root extraction, that Bernoulli equation, where we're converting that inches of water column to that usable feet per minute. If your device is not capable of doing that, that's something that you're now having to do in your building management system or your PLC. So just one more area that you can potentially introduce error when trying to convert your velocity pressure to a usable velocity in feet per minute or meters per second. One of the other advantages to using an anemometer is we know that these are working off of a temperature principle. So you have a temperature sensor there that's monitoring the temperature conditions of the supply itself. So frequently you can really get two sensors out of one device, because with thermal anemometers you're typically able to pull both your temperature output as well as your air velocity output. And that velocity output is going to be linear to that flow range, which is a nice easy input to that building management system or PLC. So today what I'm hoping you've learned from this presentation is a better understanding of Dwyer instruments and how we really qualify for manufacturing air velocity instrumentation. From the standpoint of measuring airflow for pressure-based instrumentation with pitot tubes, we learned that the fluid viscosity is the root cause of error in pitot tubes when used for measuring low flow rates. We saw that through CFD models, we can see that the local flow development is changing around the sensor static pressure holes, which leads to increased error. So with that, Dwyer then is recommending a practical limitation of 200 feet per minute for pitot tubes. On the anemometer side, or the temperature side, we saw that through the sensor characterization process, we're able to calibrate these anemometers to improve the accuracy of those sensors by accounting for things such as humidity, temperature, and pressure. Again, we looked at some CFD models that are showing that local flow development changes around the sensor that would lead to an increased error without this sensor characterization. So the references used for sensor characterization ultimately lead to improved accuracy for the target applications and velocities that you'd be monitoring with those sensors. So again, I'd like to thank you for taking time out of your schedules today to come and learn more about Dwyer instruments and air velocity sensors. If you'd like to learn more and see some live demonstrations of our temperature-based air velocity sensors, I'll be at booth 943 for the rest of the day and tomorrow. So look forward to seeing you guys.